In previous class, we have studied or learned about how this thyroid hormone is secreted from a thyroid gland, and then how these hormones are transported to the targeted organ. And we also discussed on this one the mechanism of actions of thyroid hormone. So on target cell, this T3 is more biologically active than T4 for showing its response to the in the target cell. And while talking about the actions of this thyroid hormone, so predominantly this thyroid hormone, they show its physical actions by regulating the gene transcriptions. So since these thyroid hormones, so they are lipophilic in nature, and its receptor is present on the nucleus. So these thyroid hormones, it binds with the receptor present on the nucleus, and after binding with the receptor, then it combined to the hormone responsive element of the DNA. After that, it stimulates the rate of the transcriptions of different proteins. So these hormones, these thyroid hormones, it not only shows its actions with these genetic regulations, that is the genetic actions. So it also shows its proper physical responses or its actions through the non-genetic actions. So generally, these thyroid hormones, it's bind with different cellular proteins, that the transport proteins, and then it shows its actions. So predominantly, it shows its functions via the, it shows its actions via the genetic actions, that is the regulating of rate of transcriptions. So apart from that, it also shows its functions via the non-genomic actions. That means it binds with the different transport proteins, and it shows its function. So now I will talk for today these functions of these thyroid hormones in the these targeted tissues. So this action of these thyroid hormones, so role in normal growth. So it exerts their effects directly by increasing this protein synthesis and enzymes, and indirectly by the increasing productions of growth hormones and somatomedins. So these growth hormones and somatomedins, so these are involved in the this growth of the person. So this mechanism of this metabolic growth, so the main functions of this thyroid hormones is it have a calorigenic effects or thermogenesis is the major effect of thyroid hormone. So it increases the basal metabolic rate. For the increasing of this basal metabolic rate, it increases the sodium potassium ATPase enzymes. So the sodium potassium enzymes on the cell membrane, so which increases the apart from this sodium potassium ATPase enzymes, it also enhances the these different these channels, which is these transport channels, so which increases the sodium potassium these ATPase channels, so from which it increases the activity of apart from that, it also increases the mitochondrial respirations rate, so which causes the increased ATP which causes the increased this basal metabolic rate, and that is the increasing the cellular metabolism. Apart from that, this thyroid hormone, it also acts as the uncoupler. So when there is when it acts as an uncoupler, then what happens? Instead of producing of ATP from these cellular respirations, it generates the heat. So main functions of this thyroid hormone is increasing of basal metabolic rate in the all tissues. For that, it increases the sodium potassium ATPase, and it also increases the oxygen consumption to the cell, so which in turn increases the basal metabolic rate of the cell. So apart from that, it also causes the thermogenesis. So that means the increased heat production on the cell. For that, these thyroid hormones, they act as the uncoupler. So the energy which is produced by the cellular respirations, so that is utilized as a heat. So protein metabolism. So this while we are talking about these thyroid hormones actions on the protein metabolism, so it have a dual nature. So in a normal physiological concentrations of the thyroid hormones, it causes a positive nitrogen balance. So that means this on physiological concentrations of the thyroid hormones, it enhances the protein synthesis. So by stimulating these RNA synthesis and mRNA synthesis, and after then again the translations activity, it increases the protein synthesis. So it is the anabolic in nature. However, if these thyroid hormones, if it is present in a higher concentrations, so that means in case of the hyperthyroidism, that means where the concentrations of thyroid hormone is increased, then the physiological conditions on that, what happened, it behaves as a catabolic natures to the protein, so which makes a negative nitrogen balance. So on physiological conditions, it shows the anabolic to the protein metabolism. So that means it increases the protein biosynthesis, and on higher concentrations, it degrades the protein and shows the negative nitrogen balance. So in bone metabolisms, it causes the resorptions of the bone, so which lead to the hypercalcemia and hypercalciuria. So on resorptions of the bone, so these minerals like this calcium, which is deposited in our bone, that is resorbed, and it comes to the it enters to the circulation, so which lead to the hypercalcemia, and this hypercalcemia causes the this excretions of calcium through the urine, so which lead to the hypercalciuria. So in single word, this thyroid hormone, it causes the this osteoclastic activity on the bone. So it also causes the this accumulations of protein complex in the skin, so which promotes the water retention in hypothyroidism. So that is the in lower concentrations of hormones causes the accumulations of protein complexes in the skin, so promotes water retention, and which causes the edema of the skin. So generally this myxedema, so myxedema, that is the puffiness of the face, that is the characteristics of a hypothyroidism, mostly seen in the adult. So the effects of this thyroid hormone in a carbohydrate metabolism, so its net effect is that is the hyperglycemia and glycosuria. So hyperglycemia means that is the it increases the glucose concentrations on the circulations and causes the excretions of glucose via the urine, so which called as a glycosuria. So for that so generally for that it causes the decreases the utilization of glucose by the cells, so it decreases the uptake of glucose by the cells, and decreases this glucose tolerance. It also increases the rate of glucose absorption from intestine. So it generally the actions of this thyroid hormone over a carbohydrate metabolism is that in liver it causes the gluconeogenesis, so it activates the gluconeogenesis and glycogenolysis, so which releases the glucose from liver to the circulations. At the same time, it decreases the uptake of glucose by the different tissue, different these organs, and which causes the raised glucose concentration on the circulations, so which is called as a hyperglycemia. So the effect of thyroid hormone on a carbohydrate metabolism, it increases the hepatic glycogenolysis and hepatic gluconeogenesis, so which are the sources of a free glucose to the liver, and these glucose are reduced to the circulation. So which causes the increased glucose level in a circulation. So that is called as a hyperglycemia. So on lipid, it causes a lipolysis in adipocytes. So that what happened, these free fatty acids are available in a circulation, and these free fatty acids are uptake by the cells for the energy purpose, and that's make a retentions of a glucose that minimizes the utilizations of glucose by the cell. On the same times, that these thyroid hormones, they also causes a lipogenesis by increasing activities of malic enzymes, ATP citrate, lyse, and glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase. So increases the synthesis of these fatty acids. So cholesterol metabolisms, it is in deficiency of these thyroid hormones, that is in hyperthyroidism, the concentrations of cholesterol is increased, and in hyperthyroidism, the cholesterol level on the circulation is decreased. So when there is a increased concentrations of these thyroid hormones are present, that causes the increases the LDL receptors, so that the maximum cholesterol is uptake by the tissues. So on hypothyroidism, that means decreased thyroid hormones, then that decreases the LDL receptors, so that what happened, the clearance of cholesterol from the circulations, that means uptake of cholesterol from the circulation is decreased, so that these cholesterols are retained in the circulation itself, so which causes a hypercholesterolemia. So lipoproteins, so increase LDL cholesterol in hypothyroidism and decrease LDL in hyperthyroidism. So the mechanism is same. So when there is the less number of LDL receptors, then what happened is LDL will not be cleared from the circulation. So which makes a retentions of this LDL cholesterol in a circulation. So there is an increased LDL in hypothyroidism and decreased LDL in hyperthyroidism. So vitamins, and this thyroid hormone is necessary for the hepatic conversions of carotene. So that is the pro vitamin A to the active vitamin A. So carotenoids or carotene. So these are the pro vitamins, and these are the conversions of these pro vitamins to the this active vitamin A is takes place in a hepatocytes, and for the conversions it require a vitamin A. And one thing, that when there is a excess this thyroid hormones is present in a body, it increases the metabolic activity of the cell, and for the metabolic activity of the cell we need a lots of coenzymes, and these coenzymes is provided by a water soluble vitamin. So when we administer a large doses of a thyroid hormone, so that ultimately increases the requirements of water soluble vitamins like this thiamine, pyridoxine, pantothenic acids, and vitamin C. So which acts as the coenzyme for a different metabolism which takes place in the cell. So when these hormones are providing, so it increases the metabolic rate of the cells, and for continuing the increased rate of metabolic rate, we should supply the these coenzyme necessary for that different reactions, and these coenzymes are provided by these water soluble vitamins. So when we administer the large doses of thyroid hormones, so the body also require a large amounts of these water soluble vitamins. So these are the functions of these thyroid hormones. So the different effects of these thyroid hormones on the functions. So now we'll move on to the disorders of thyroid hormones. So when there is the excessive productions of thyroid hormones takes place in the body, so that is called as a hyperthyroidism. And when the body secretes low concentrations of thyroid hormones, then it is called as a hypothyroidism. So hyperthyroidism, excessive productions of thyroid hormone; hypothyroidism, deficiency of thyroid hormones. So that is the less productions of thyroid hormone than the required. So common causes for hyperthyroidism. So that is the Graves' disease. So we know that this for the synthesis of thyroid hormones from a thyroid gland, that thyroid stimulating hormone, which is secreted by the pituitary. So it is necessary. This thyroid stimulating hormone, it stimulates the all the steps of thyroid hormone biosynthesis in a thyroid gland. So in this in Graves disease, so in that what happened, this similar type of, that means this thyroid stimulating hormones, so it produces the similar type of immunoglobulins or proteins which acts as a thyroid stimulating hormone, so which causes the increased synthesis of a thyroid hormone from the gland, so that which ultimately increases the concentrations of thyroid hormones in the circulations and lead to the hyperthyroidism. So Graves' disease, so that is the autoimmune disease with a synthesis of a protein, so which stimulates the thyroid stimulating hormone. So toxic multinodular goiter, so multiple thyroid nodules secreting thyroid hormones. So on this Graves' disease, what happened, it produces a immunoglobulin G, so which acts on the this TSH receptors present on thyroid gland, and so that it increases the this all the steps of thyroid hormone synthesis. So toxic multinodular goiter, so it is a multiple thyroid nodules secreting a thyroid hormones. Solitary toxic adenoma, so which causes a single thyroid nodules autonomously producing a thyroid hormone. So these are the common causes for a hyperthyroidism, and less common causes, so which causes a hyperthyroidism, are subacute thyroiditis, so which is the inflammation of thyroiditis leading to the release of thyroid hormones, and some these administrations of the some drugs, so iatrogenic, so that also causes a hyperthyroidism, so excess exogenous thyroid hormone administrations, and also this is hyperthyroidism also seen on the ectopic thyroid tissues. So such as is functional thyroid cancer metastasis and stroma ovaries, so which causes the increase that is thyroid hormone biosynthesis. So classifications, so generally this hyperthyroidism can be classified into the two, so that that is the on which organ is affected, so that this thyroid hormone synthesizes increase. So secondary hyperthyroidisms, so on this in, so we know that this for the thyroid hormone synthesis by the thyroid gland, so it should be stimulated by a this one pituitary or hypothalamic hormones. So when there is the effects defects on the this pituitary or hypothalamus regions, so because of that what happened, the excess TSH is secreted, then this excess TSH, it activates the synthesis of thyroid hormones from a thyroid gland. So such cases of hyperthyroidism, so that is grouped under the secondary hyperthyroidisms. So this secondary hyperthyroidism, in simple way, if we say that, so the hyperthyroidism due to the secondary cause. So secondary cause means that is the defects is on the pituitary or hypothalamus. So which causes a increased secretions of TSH, and this increased TSH, it stimulates the increased synthesis of thyroid hormone. So primary hyperthyroidisms. So primary hyperthyroidism means the secretions of thyroid hormone increases due to the disease of thyroid gland. So generally, so most this commonly seen this primary hyperthyroidism is that is seen in a Graves disease. So toxic multinodular goiter, toxic adenoma, functioning metastatic thyroid carcinoma, so TSH receptor mutations, stroma ovary, and iodine excess. So it directly affect on the synthesis of thyroid hormones from a thyroid gland. So symptoms of hyperthyroidism. So the symptoms of hyperthyroidism is that is the weight loss, so palpitations, anxiety, heat tolerance, so sweating, greasy skin, diarrhea, oligomenorrhea. So hypothyroidism. So hypothyroidism means that is the decreased thyroid hormones concentrations in a circulations. So the common causes for hypothyroidism is that is the atropic hypothyroidism, so diffuse lymphatic infiltrate, and Hashimoto's thyroiditis. So it is asymptomatic thyroiditis. It is also a autoimmune disorder on which the antibody produced against a thyroid peroxidase enzyme. So when so in this what happened is thyroid peroxidase enzymes, they are destroyed by a body due to the presence of antibodies against it. So on lack of this thyroid thyroid peroxidase enzymes, thyroid gland are unable to synthesize thyroid hormones, so which lead to the hypothyroidism. So less common, these are iodine deficiency. So we know that, so for the synthesis of this thyroid hormone from a thyroid gland, it need a two precursors. So one is thyroglobulin, so that's a protein, so which is synthesized in a thyroid gland by using a different amino acids. And next necessary minerals is, that is the iodine, so which should be supplied from a dietary source. And this iodine deficiency hypothyroidism, so that is the most common these hypothyroidisms that is presents over the worldwide. So especially the regions where the soil and water content of iodine is poor. So when there is a sufficient amount of iodine is not present, then what happens? This thyroid hormone biosynthesis is altered, so which lead to the hypothyroidism. So it is most common in the worldwide. So iodine deficiency hypothyroidism, and this is the common hypothyroidism that is seen in these mountainous countries like this Nepal. So it iatrogenic. So generally, it is hypothyroidism that's seen in the post-surgery. So anti-thyroid agents, so providing of these drugs like anti-thyroid agents such as a carbimazole, radioactive iodine treatments, and other drugs like lithium, iodine. So that also lead to the hypothyroidism. And another cause for hypothyroidism is hypopituitarism. So which is a rare. And on this, what happened? There is pituitary organs is not able to synthesize and secrete this TSH hormone, which is necessary for the synthesis of a thyroid hormone from a thyroid gland. So less unable to synthesize TSH hormones, so which is seen on the pituitary tumors, postpartum ischemic necrosis. So classifications like these hypothyroidisms, this hypothyroidism also can be classified into two groups. So that is the secondary hypothyroidisms and primary hypothyroidism. So that secondary hypothyroidism, so that is the hypothyroidism due to the disease of pituitary of hypothalamus. So generally seen in tumor, pituitary surgery or irradiations, infiltrations. So Sjögren syndrome and isolated TSH deficiency. And primary hypothyroidism, so that is the due to the disease of thyroid gland. So most commonly these causes for a primary hypothyroidism are, that's the asymptomatothyroiditis. So where these immunoglobulins, that is the protein antibodies against the thyroid peroxidase enzymes is produced. Thyroidectomy and radiation therapy. So where this thyroid glands is not able to synthesize thyroid hormones. So there is another type of this hypothyroidism is also there. So which is called as a congenital hypothyroidism. So on this, what happened? The enzymes, which is necessary for the synthesis of thyroid hormones in a thyroid gland, such as this one, this thyroid peroxidase, and this absence, lack of this sodium ion, this sodium ion symporters. So which affects the synthesis of thyroid hormones. And generally this congenital hypothyroidism, that is generally seen in the children's, that is the early birth of the children's. And those persons who have this type of congenital hypothyroidism, so that affects the growth of a person, so which lead to the cretinism. So cretinism means that is the short, so that affects the growth, so that means a dwarfism and mental retardations. So symptoms of this hypothyroidism is, that is the tiredness, lethargy, intolerance to cold, weight gain, constipations, amenorrhea, poor cognizance, dry skin, and hair. And this cretinism is the most common in a, it's the most common that affects on the hyperthyroidism that is seen in the children. And mostly this cretinism also seen on the, on those childs, so who is given birth by a hyperthyroidism murder. So murder with a hyperthyroidism. So now I will move on to the next topic, that is the thyroid function test. So generally this thyroid function test that is done to know the status of a thyroid gland, functional status of a gland. And it is also generally done to characterize the anatomical features of the thyroid gland and to possibly evaluate the cause for thyroid dysfunctions. So by evaluating these different parameters that is under the thyroid function test, so we can evaluate the cause of thyroid dysfunction, whether the that is the primary this primary cause or a secondary cause. So different tests that is performed to conduct this thyroid function test, and this test can be divided into the two groups, whether if it is performed in a laboratory, that is called as a in vitro test, and if the, it is performed in a this person itself, it is called as a vivo test, in vivo. In vitro, that is the outside the body, in vivo, that is conducted inside the body. So in vitro test, so that is the most common test that is done performed in a thyroid function. So these are the serum TSH, serum T3 and T4. So estimations of T3, T4 and TSH. So that is commonly done in a hospital for to know the status of a thyroid. So functional status of a thyroid. So apart from that, the other test that is done is that blood TBG. So that is the blood proteins. So which carry a thyroid hormones, that is a thyroid binding globulins. This resin optic test. So thyroid test of this thyroid autoantibodies. So this test of thyroid autoantibodies, they are generally performed to establish the this Graves disease and then this Hashimoto's disease. And this blood TBG test, resin optic test. So these are the less. So these tests are nowadays out of date. So they have a this historical importance only. So in vivo test, so that's a thyroid iodine uptake. So TRH stimulating test, TSH stimulating test, and this TRH stimulating test, TSH stimulating test, they are generally done to establish the to differentiate the to locate the site of, to locate the distinguish the secondary hyper or hypothyroidism. So now I will discuss individually. So serum thyroid stimulating hormone. So the estimations of TSH level. So TSH levels are important parameter of thyroid disorder. So which test the integrity of hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. So normal level is it is 2 to 6 microunits per ml, and this test is generally performed in a hospital as a single test also, and generally it differentiate the whether the person is in the hyper or hypo or in a normal. So to distinguish that, this TSH test is widely or commonly done in a hospital. So in this clinical interpretations of this TSH test, so generally it is the concentrations of TSH is increased in primary hypothyroidism. So we know that the secretions and synthesis of TSH, that is controlled by a negative feedback mechanisms. So when there is a low concentrations of T3 and T4 in a circulations, then it increases the synthesis of TSH from a pituitary gland. So in hypothyroidism, so where primary hypothyroidism, where this T3 and T4 is decreased. So on that, what happened? We can see the increased concentrations of TSH. And generally, this TSH level is decreased in case of primary hyperthyroidism. So in primary hyperthyroidism, what happened? There is the increased concentrations of the T3 and T4. And this increased T3 and T4, it inhibits the synthesis and secretions of TSH from a pituitary gland so that the concentrations of TSH will be decreased in the circulations. So secondary hypothyroidism. So where pituitary or hypothalamus is affected, so that what happened? This TSH cannot be secreted and synthesized from a pituitary gland. So tertiary hypothyroidism. So this secondary hypothyroidism, where pituitary gland is affected. Tertiary hypothyroidism, where this hypothalamus is affected. So when this hypothalamus is affected, then it is not able to synthesize thyroid releasing hormone TRH from hypothalamus. So in absence of TRH, this pituitary gland cannot synthesize and secrete the TSH, so that the concentrations of TSH is decreased in the circulation. Subclinical hyper and hypothyroidism. So generally, this hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism, while comparing with the concentrations of these thyroid hormones T3 and T4, if this T3 and T4 it is normal and the concentrations of TSH is low or high, then this is categorized as the so we are discussing on this thyroid function test. So on that we are in a these estimations of this one TSH. So TSH, so it is generally used to distinguish the normal function test from this to establish the hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism, or the person is in the normal functions. So generally what happened is in case of hyperthyroidism, the concentrations of TSH is decreased due to the negative feedback regulations. So that means when there is excess T3 or T4 in the circulations, it inhibits the secretion and the synthesis and secretions of TSH. So low TSH, increased T3 and T4 is seen in hyperthyroidism, and high TSH, lower T3 and T4 is seen in hypothyroidism. And this type of this hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism is called as a overt hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism. And this overt hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism is the it is also called as a clinical hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism. There is the another part is also there, which is called as a subclinical hyper and subclinical hypothyroidism. And the differentiation between this subclinical and clinical this hyper and hypothyroidism is that in case of clinical hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism, what happened? This T4 and T3, they are also in a abnormal values. In subclinical, what happened? These T3 and T4 concentrations, they are within a normal level, but there is alterations on the TSH concentrations, which we call as a subclinical hyper and hypothyroidism. So if the T3 and T4 is normal and there is a low concentrations of TSH, then it is called as a subclinical hyperthyroidism. And if this is a T4 and T3, that is in a normal level, but there is an increased concentrations of TSH, then it is called as a subclinical hypothyroidism. So increased TSH, but normal T4 and T3, that is a subclinical hypothyroidism. So decreased TSH, but normal T4 and T3, then it is the subclinical hyperthyroidism. So in clinical, what happened? Increased T3 and T4 and decreased TSH. So clinical hypothyroidism, increased TSH, but lower T3 and T4. So when there is a lower concentrations of T4 and T3, that enhance the synthesis of TSH, so that there is the increased TSH in the circulation. So increased TSH, lower T4 and T3, that is the clinical hypothyroidism. So serum total T4 and T3. So we know that these thyroid hormones, when we look on these thyroid hormones on the circulations, 99.05% of T4, they are bound with a plasma proteins. So very low amounts of this T4 and T3, they are found in the free forms. So it is quite easy to determine the serum total T4 and T3. So where the concentrations of both free and bound thyroid hormones estimation is done. And due to the advancement of the technology, nowadays it is easy to measure of a free T4 and T3. So the differentiations of this measurement of total T4 and T3 from a free T4 and T3. So then these are, when we measure a total T4 and T3, these the concentrations of total T4 and T3 is also affected by a concentrations of plasma proteins. So which we study, which we learned in a previous class. So what we learned is that in case of a pregnant woman, what happened? There is a increased synthesis of thyroxine binding protein TBG. So which causes a increased concentrations of thyroid hormone in the circulation. So if we do not measure a thyroid binding globulin, so that is a proteins, if we measure a only total thyroid hormones in case of a pregnant, then what happened? Though the person is a normal, but we can see a hyperthyroidism by seeing a result. So where the thyroid hormones may be the double. So if we measure a direct T3 or T4 on a pregnant woman, then we can get a actual thyroid hormone concentrations in the person. So it is not affected by the concentrations of a proteins. So if we measure this one serum direct, this total proteins, total T3 and T4, we should measure plasma proteins also, that is a thyroid binding globulins also we have to measure. So the estimations of this T3 and T4, that is commonly done to rule out the hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism. So normally what happened, in case of hyperthyroidism, the concentrations of T3 and T4 will be increased, and in hypothyroidism instead, what happened, this T3 and T4 will be decreased. So the normal level is, normal level for this T3 and T4 is, in case of the total, the T4 is, that is 5 to 12.5 microgram per deciliter, and in T3 it is 70 to 200 nanogram per deciliter. So we're talking of the free T4, it is 10 to 27 picomole per liter, and T3 it is 3 to 9 picomole per liter. So by nowadays, by the using of this high sensitive ELISA test, or this one development of the CLIA and RIA, now it is possible to measure a free T4 and T3 in the serum. So which will minimize the interference by the plasma protein. So clinical interpretation, so value increase in hyperthyroidism. So if we talk about the total thyroid hormones, so this total thyroid hormone also increase during increased concentrations of thyroid binding globulin, which is seen in pregnancy and with a estrogen therapy. So value decrease in case of hyperthyroidism, and also this total T4 and T3 will be decreased in case of the decreased concentrations of thyroid binding globulin. So generally seen in case of the nephrotic syndrome, so where the excessive protein is lost, and in liver disease, where the biosynthesis of protein, plasma protein will be diminished. So it is a thyroxine binding globulin. So estimations of TBG. So then nowadays this TBG, so due to the development of the direct estimations of free thyroid hormones, that is a free T3 and T4, these thyroxine binding estimations of thyroxine binding globulin has only the historic importance. So the estimations of thyroxine binding globulin is necessary only when we measure a total plasma total T3 and T4 in a plasma concentrations. So the normal level of thyroxine binding globulin is around 12 to 28 microgram per ml. So abnormal TBG found is, so increased level is generally seen in case of the pregnancy, so estrogen therapy. And decreased level of thyroid binding globulin is generally seen in case of a nephrotic syndrome, so liver disease and malnutrition. So that is where hypoproteinemic state is seen. So in these cases, the concentrations of thyroid binding globulin is decreased. So thyroid autoantibodies. So generally, these detections of thyroid autoantibodies are done to demonstrate the different diseases, like it is Graves' disease or Hashimoto's disease. So presence of antibodies against a thyroid peroxidase, then it is called as a Hashimoto's disease. So presence of these thyroid stimulating immunoglobulins, then it is called as a Graves' disease. So Hashimoto disease, that is related with a hypothyroidism. So Graves' disease, it is related with a hyperthyroidism. Radioactive iodine uptake. So we know that this for the biosynthesis of thyroid hormones from a thyroid gland, it necessary a iodine. So the generally the normal to detect the functioning of thyroid gland, so these tests are also done. And in this radioactive iodine uptake test, what happened, the patient is passed to the patient, this certain amounts of this iodine is given orally, and after that the detections of iodine is done by using a machine over a neck, so that is on the over a thyroid gland. So in normally what happens, so if the person is normal, then generally what happens, the iodine uptake is around 1 to 13% after the 2 hours of the administrations of this iodine. And generally 20 to 40% of iodine is uptake by a thyroid gland after 24 hours of iodine administered. But the person is in a hyperthyroidic state, then what happened? It uptake a maximum amounts of iodine. And if the person is in a hypothyroidic state, then what happened? The uptake of iodine is decreased. So generally in hyperthyroidism state, the 60% of iodine is can be seen on over the neck. So uptake can be seen. And in hypothyroidism, so less than 20% of iodine uptake can be seen after 24 hours. So TRH stimulation test. So generally this type of stimulation test, they are done to locate the pathological site lesion. So where the gland, where the this hypothalamo hypopituitary axis is altered. So this TRS stimulation test, it is used to locate the site of pathologic lesion for hypothyroid state. So generally in this case, what happened, 200 to 400 microgram of thyrotropic releasing hormone is administered via intravenously, and the blood sample at 0, 20, 40 and 60 minutes are analyzed for a TSH content. So when we give a TRH hormone, then it stimulates the synthesis of TSH. So if the person is normal, then what happened? So after the administering of TRH, there will be the enhance. It stimulates the synthesis of TSH. So the concentrations of TSH will be increased. So in normal cases, what happened? The peak response in normal is 4 times increase of TSH level at 20 and 40 minute sample as compared to the basal TSH level, the TSH level at 0. So in case of a primary hypothyroidism, so there will be the exaggerated and prolonged. So in primary hypothyroidism, what happened? The TSH secretions will be exaggerated and prolonged after the administrations of TRS. That means, so the increased synthesis of TSH. In secondary hypothyroidism. So what happened? So there is, so after providing of TRS also, there will be the no response. So blunted. In tertiary, what happened? So increase in TSH is delayed. So the TSH secretions will be increased, but it is delayed in case of a tertiary hypothyroidism. Now TSH stimulating test. So TSH stimulating test is also similar with a TRH stimulating test. And generally this TSH stimulating test is useful in differentiating primary hypothyroidism from a secondary hypothyroidism. So after these for preparations of the patient, so after 24 hours of radioiodine uptake studies, so 3 injections of thyroid stimulating hormone. So each 5 USP units are given 24 hours interval. So 24 hours thyroidal radioiodine uptake measured after the 42 hours of a final TSH dose. So in case of the primary, what happened? Failure to stimulations. So if the persons have a primary hypothyroidism, then the persons are unable to uptake a thyroid, uptake of this one iodine. So failure to stimulations of this TSH. And in the case of the secondary, what I mean, stimulations of gland showing a increased radioiodine uptake. So after providing of TSH, the thyroid is able to uptake a iodine. So this is the TSH stimulating test. So radio imaging. So generally this type of test is done commonly in the hospital, and generally it is done to know about the shape and size of nodules in a thyroid gland. So generally it is done that USG ultrasonogram of thyroid glands. And apart from that, this is nowadays this thyroid scans by this CT scans or MRI. So these all are under the radio imaging of thyroid gland. So generally it is generally these tests are common to know the anatomical positions and the anatomical shape and size of a thyroid gland. So apart from that, this thyroid scan is also done by providing that is radionuclide scans of by giving of this radioactive iodines like this 131i or 99 mtc. It detects the hot and cold nodules in the thyroid. So this is all about the thyroid function test. And on the same time, we'll also study this one another thyroid hormone. So that is the calcitonin. So which is involved in the this calcium phosphate homeostasis. So if you have any questions regarding to these topics, you can ask by keeping these questions on Viber or in other media. I will be available and I'll try to give answers to my best. So now thank you for your participations, and now we'll end these lectures. So on next class we'll study this on parathyroid hormones.